Well, good morning, everybody. So nice to see you today. It's a beautiful day to be in the house of the Lord. Let's stand together this morning and let's worship.
To God be the glory, great things he has done. So loved he the world that he gave us his son, who yielded his life and atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he has done. A perfect redemption, a purchase of blood, to every believer the promise of God. The vilest offender truly believes that moment from Jesus a pardon receives. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory. Taught us great things he has done, and great our rejoicing through Jesus the Son. But purer and higher and greater will be our wonder, our transport when Jesus we see. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he has done.
Amen, amen. Please be seated.
Church. There I am. Good to have you guys here this morning. I do have a few announcements for you. Don't forget that TCC now has a new app that you can go to your app store, whether you have Android or Apple, download that. You can take sermon notes. Those of you watching online, we welcome you in. You can also watch us live streaming through the app if you'd like. You can send prayer requests, give, several things like that. So we'd encourage you to download that app and utilize that to its capabilities. Also coming up this Friday and Saturday is the IF gathering for our women's ministry. So on Friday, that begins at 6 o'clock, goes to about 9:30. And then on Saturday, it's from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. Tickets are $10. And so be sure and just go to tongicc.org to sign up for that. Also, our parking lot work will begin Monday. Lord willing, it will begin on Monday. So we're not exactly sure what next Sunday will look like as far as parking goes. So just kind of be ready for that. We will, if we need to, we'll have parking lot attendants out there to direct you where it's safe to park. But just be sure during the week, if you plan to come to the office, you might just call us beforehand so that we can tell you where you can park, where you can be, so that your vehicle stays safe. Also, a couple other things to make note of. We are going to be doing some parking at the fair for a fundraiser. One of the local Christian churches, actually Disciples of Christ from Leavenworth, called us and asked us if we could take over doing the parking at the fair. It's a pretty good fundraiser that they've done for several years. And I said, yeah, I think we could do that. So we're going to work with them this year and train ourselves. They will train us. Next year, we'll take that on. What we need is about six people every night of the fair just to help us. So if you're interested in doing that, it's real simple. It's from 5 p.m. to 9, just coming and directing traffic, taking money to park people at the fair. We would love to have your help with that. We're going to split the proceeds this year with that church, and the next year we'll utilize that for whatever we deem we want to, really. We could do the entire Backpack Buddy program with that fundraiser if we wanted to and supply all that, all those meals. But we'll decide as we move forward with that. But that is coming up on the horizon. So it's if you would like to volunteer for that, contact the church office and contact me or one of the other ministers, and we'll let you know what's going on with that. Also, don't forget blood drive at the end of the month too, and you can sign up online for that. And don't forget to fill out your connection card. I would do have a thank you note here that I wanted to read to you guys. This is from Vintage Park. It's actually a couple of notes here. The food that was left over from our 150th Saturday celebration, we took over to Vintage Park and took over all the meat, all the sides, and even the ice cream. And so several of the folks there signed their names to this. It simply says, "Dear friends, thank you for the cookies and the ice cream. We really enjoyed them. It was so nice of you to share." And then from the actual staff over there at Vintage Park, it says, "Dear Christian Church, thank you so much for the donation of food and treats. Your gift came at a time of need and is greatly appreciated. Happy anniversary." So I thought that was great that we were able to kind of share some of what we had with those folks over there. Right now, why don't you stand and turn to those around you and greet each other this morning.
Sorry, y'all, we're having some technical difficulties with our live stream this morning, and so I was trying to double duty on that, but I need to be here with you, and I'm excited to be here with you. Are you excited to be here? Two of you. Awesome. Well, hopefully we'll get that figured out. Right now, it's not working too well, but we will make that adjustment. That just means folks need to come to church, right? That's all it means. That's all it means. If you're here in a building, it works. So, all right, let's continue to sing this morning.
There is a name I love to hear, I love to sing its word. It sounds like music in my ear, the sweetest name on earth. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, because he first loved me. It tells me of a Savior's love who died to set me free. It tells me of his precious blood, the sinner's perfect plea. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, because he first loved me. first loved me. It tells of one whose loving heart can feel my deepest woe, who in each sorrow bears a part that none can bear below. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus, because he first loved me. When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, my richest gain I count but loss.
got to get my Bible out here. Just a minute. It's one of them electric ones. So I'm going to read 1 Corinthians 11:23-26. For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which was broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes." Whenever I was around 6 years old, I remember going to church with my mom, and I got kind of excited because I saw a plate of bread coming around. And there was also some juice being passed around. I got really excited about that, but unfortunately, she stopped me before I could do anything. I just thought it was because on the off chance that I might make a mess. It wasn't it. It wasn't until much later in life that I would learn the significance and embrace the gift of communion. The Lord's Supper is significant to all of us for multiple reasons. In the scripture I just read, Paul writes how the Lord's Supper is given to us by God himself as a means to bring unity in the body of Christ. Also, when we observe the Lord's Supper, we recognize that the table looks in three different directions: past, present, and future. Past, it looks to the past for commemoration. The Lord's Supper refers to the last Passover meal that Jesus had with his disciples here on earth. At that time, Jesus took the bread and the cup and passed them around, signifying his body would be broken and that the shedding of his blood would usher in the new covenant. And we may hear something about that in Jeremiah as we're studying that in 31:31. It says, "The day is coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the people of Israel and Judah." Therefore, the Lord's Supper makes us remember that Jesus, what he did on the cross. That is why he says, "Do this in remembrance of me," in both verses 24 and 25. Paul is stressing that we are to always remember the atoning sacrifices of Jesus upon the cross. We are to remember how he was flogged, beaten, and he shed his blood to take away our sin. The present, communion. The Lord's Supper speaks of present and how we have fellowship with the living Christ. We have communion with him now because our sins are forgiven. We do not have to wait for heaven to have fellowship with God. We can have communion with him now. Not only do we have communion with God, but we can have communion with other believers. This brings unity out of division, which was exactly what was happening in Corinth when Paul wrote that letter. Future commitment. We are to continually observe the Lord's Supper, as it says in verse 26, till he comes. Therefore, this table also looks ahead to Christ's return. It reminds us that Jesus is victorious, and he will set up his kingdom here on earth. We are to proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again in the future. It also signifies the destruction of Satan, when Jesus will return in victory. We won't be taking communion at that point. We'll have the banquet table, and Satan will be defeated. The Lord's Supper keeps us focused on the cross, draws us into fellowship with God and the body of Christ. It gives us hope of the resurrection, the promise of victory over Satan and sin, and the truth of heaven. Heavenly Father, as we come to the table, help us reflect on the past, the present, and the future. And help us focus especially on your incredible love and faithfulness. In Jesus' most holy name, amen.
Jeremiah last week, and our focus was more specifically on Jeremiah's call. That's what we looked at. We didn't really start with any symbols, but there's this call from a would-be priest, that's what he was going to be, to now the call will be to become a prophet. And now we're going to start looking at some of the major symbols that we find throughout the book. As I joked last week, we're not going to do 52 weeks of Jeremiah, even though the book lines up perfectly for that. Someday, maybe, but we're going to be in Jeremiah 13 today, so if you have a physical Bible or you have a Bible on your phone, you could open up to the first 11 verses there. We're going to look at the symbol of the belt, and I want to read the entirety of the text to you this morning before we even get started. So this is the NIV today, and I'll try to let you know, and I think maybe even on the screen it will show you whether or not it's NIV or NLT. If not, I'll try to mention it. But this is the NIV, Jeremiah 13, verse 1. This is what the Lord said to me. Go and buy a linen belt and put it round your waist, but do not let it touch water. So I bought a belt, as the Lord directed, and I put it round my waist. Then the word of the Lord came to me a second time. Take the belt you bought and are wearing round your waist and go now to Perath and hide it there in a crevice in the rocks. So I went and hid it at Perath as the Lord told me. And many days later, the Lord said to me, go now to Perath and get the belt I told you to hide there. So I went to Perath and dug up the belt and took it from the place where I had hidden it, but now it was ruined and completely useless. Then the word of the Lord came to me. This is what the Lord says. In the same way, I will ruin the pride of Judah and the great pride of Jerusalem. These wicked people who refuse to listen to my words, who follow the stubbornness of their hearts and go after other gods to serve and worship them, will be like this belt, completely useless. For as a belt is bound round a man's waist, so I bound the whole house of Israel and the whole house of Judah to me, declares the Lord, to be my people for my renown and praise and honor. But they have not listened. Let's pray. Father, we come before you this morning and we are thankful for the book of Jeremiah. and just this prophet whom you asked to do something incredibly hard, to preach to a nation that did not want to hear it. And they didn't want to hear this, I'm sure. I hope that we will hear it, though. Lord, I hope that you will help us to take in what it is that we need to hear from these very words that we just heard. There is something in this that can be applied to us. We're not going to cheat the text this morning, Lord. I don't want to do that. We know this was for the nation of Judah. We know why he's saying it. But we also understand that your word is living and active. And even in the Old Testament stories like this, we can bring application to our own lives and learn from those before us. So help us to do that today, Lord. Teach us what this passage means. Speak through me as I try to do that. Help me to do this with clarity. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. We've all heard the stories. Some of you may have even lived out the truth of the fact that seatbelts save lives. Right? Year after year, we hear about or we read about someone's testimony that a seatbelt, because they were buckled in after a major wreck, that seatbelt saved their lives. Law enforcement agencies, they use that slogan often, seatbelts save lives. The other one they use is click it or ticket, right? You better buckle up or you're going to get a ticket. And I won't make you raise your hands if you've ever gotten a ticket for that. But that this is important, right? Seatbelts are incredibly important because they keep you bound to the seat so that if you are in a wreck, you have less of a chance to be thrown from the vehicle. In Jeremiah's day, they had no use for seatbelts, of course. But linen belts tied around the waist would help you in just kind of keeping the clothing close to your body as you would move and do things throughout the day. It wouldn't necessarily save your life, but it might save you some embarrassment if the wind started to blow a little bit and the robe and the tunic starts to do things. I'm just being honest, okay? So it could save you in that particular way. But the belt would simply just keep things in place, keep things where they were meant to be. Now, you may notice that some of the translations are going to describe this belt a little differently. Some of them say a linen loincloth. I've even seen some translations that say a girdle. Now, maybe some of you know what that is, maybe you don't. But what God had Jeremiah go purchase was essentially a belt. He told him to not put it in water. Don't let it touch water. That actually would have made it softer and more comfortable. And we don't know how long he wore the belt. Text doesn't really say, but some amount of time had passed. And then God says, I want you to take that belt and go hide it. The NIV says he went to Perith. That's a town near the Euphrates River. That's 300 miles away. But he does what God told him. And so he takes it and he hides this belt, this linen belt, in the crevice of a rock. Many days later, again, we don't know how many days, the Hebrew does seem to indicate that it was a long time had passed. God tells him, go back and get the belt. So he dug up and he found the belt, but because it was linen, the belt was ruined and it was completely useless. And as it turns out, this wasn't just God giving a test to Jeremiah to see if he was going to be obedient to him. This was different. This was really an action sermon of Jeremiah. The rotten belt was a description of how God was going to rot away the pride of Judah. Now, if they continued to follow their own desires and just ignore God, then they were going to become like Jeremiah's belt, just rotten and ruined. The NLT describes Judah like this in Jeremiah 13:10. Therefore, they will become like this loincloth, good for nothing. Judah's going to be good for nothing, just a worn out, rotten belt. Now, the belt image is a warning to Judah, and unfortunately, they will choose not to listen, and they become useless to God. They become good for nothing. And yes, this is a warning that's not necessarily written directly to us, but church, we better learn from other people's mistakes. I hope you learn from other people's mistakes because you are the belt. We're the belt. I mean, God's pretty clear about that. Jeremiah 13:11, he says, as a loincloth clings to a man's waist, so I created Judah and Israel to cling to me, says the Lord. They were to be my people, my pride, my glory, and honor to my name. In the Old Testament, the nation of Israel was God's chosen people. Now listen, they never should have split into two nations where Israel's in the north and Judah's in the south. That never should have happened, but it did. The nation as a whole was supposed to be this special people set apart from the rest, and through that nation would come the Messiah. God created that nation to cling to him like a belt clings to our waist. They were created to cling to God. And in the New Testament, God establishes the church. He establishes us, and we become his people. That's clear in Galatians 6:16, where it says, may God's peace and mercy be upon all who live by this principle. They are the new people of God. Do you hear me? We are the new people of God. So it is not a stretch to apply this text in Jeremiah to our situation today. In the Old Testament, God longed for his people to cling to him like a belt. He has Jeremiah literally live out an action sermon so they can visually see that they are a belt. They were created to hold tightly to him, and now you are a belt. Now we are the new people of God. Do you cling to him? Do you hold tight to God like a belt holds clothes together? God brought the nation of Israel close to him, and he brings us close to himself as well. Imagine God just tightening up that belt one more notch just to make sure that you stay close and secure. He wants you to cling to him through all of life's ups and downs, but sadly, not everyone does that. Judah didn't. They defiled themselves by worshiping idols, and they became good for nothing, the text says. And I find it ironic that God told Jeremiah not to let the belt touch water, simply because one of the bigger issues the church in America is facing is the watering down of the gospel. The truth of Scripture is just watered down nowadays. It makes it more palatable to fit a certain ideology. And if Jeremiah had placed that belt in water, it would have conformed a little better to his body, would have been a little bit more comfortable. And that's what some in the church are doing with the Scriptures, watering it down so that it fits and that it forms to what they believe or to what we believe instead of what the Bible actually says. And here's the truth, guys. We shouldn't be taken off guard by that. We really shouldn't. Paul told Timothy years ago in 2 Timothy 2:3, for a time is coming when people will no longer listen to sound and wholesome teaching. They will follow their own desires, and they will look for teachers who will tell them whatever their itching ears want to hear. They will reject the truth and chase after myths. It happened then, it happens now. But the question you need to ask yourself this morning is that if you are a belt, what kind of belt are you? Are you the kind of belt that's strong and sturdy, that's tight and secure? Or would you see yourself more like the belt from this story? Jeremiah 13:7, the NLT version here, it says the belt was rotting away and falling apart. The NIV says the belt was ruined, completely useless. I hope that you don't see yourself as ruined and completely useless, because you are not. You're not. I don't care what has happened to you in your life, the ups and downs of your life, the things that have been so difficult, even the sins that maybe you've struggled with, you are not useless. You don't have to be. And maybe you need to repent. Maybe you need to turn from some of the things that you're doing. That's what Jeremiah was trying to get Judah to do. He tried to get them to repent, to cling to the Lord like a belt around the waist. Jeremiah 4, verse 1, it says, O Israel, says the Lord, if you wanted to return to me, you could. You could throw away your detestable idols and stray away no more. then when you swear by my name, saying, as surely as the Lord lives, you could do so with truth, justice, and righteousness. Then you would be a blessing to the nations of the world, and all people would come and praise my name. They could have repented. They could have repented and clung to the Lord, but they didn't. And you guys have that same choice too. And if you're feeling like this rotten belt from the story, repent and turn back to God, or maybe turn to God for the first time. It is not too late. It eventually became too late for the people of Judah. It did. Instead of clinging to the Lord, they were clinging to Baal, and they were worshiping idols. And because they had become useless and just a rotten belt, God chose to rot away their pride. Jeremiah 13:9, it says, this is what the Lord says. This shows how I will rot away the pride of Judah and Jerusalem. Pride has always been a sin that man has struggled with. And sadly, we now have a Pride Month, a month in which we take pride in our sinfulness. There's going to come a day when God will rot away that pride, just like he did for Judah. Do you know why God chose to rot away their pride? It's there in the text, Jeremiah 13:10. These wicked people refused to listen to me. At the end of verse 11, after God describes Judah as this nation he created to cling to him, a nation that should have brought him honor and glory, instead they chose to just not listen. They didn't listen to him. They didn't want to be a belt that was clinging to God. Because if you're going to be a belt that clings to God, you have to listen to what he says. That was Judah's downfall. They just would not listen. They wouldn't even listen to the prophet of God. Even when he performed a sermon in such a visual way, it didn't matter. Who do you listen to? Who gets the most attention from you? Answering that question will, to some degree, determine what kind of belt you are. Proverbs 2, starting in verse 1, it says, my children, listen to what I say. Treasure my commands. Tune your ears to wisdom and concentrate on understanding. Cry out for insight and ask for understanding. Search for them as you would for silver. Seek them like hidden treasures. Then you will understand what it means to fear the Lord, and you will gain knowledge of God. We need to be good listeners of God. Have you ever had a conversation with someone, but in your mind you were kind of distracted, and so you could hear them speaking, but you didn't actually listen to what they said? I'm sure we've all been there. I know that there are times when I'll be working on something and the boys will come up to me and they'll just immediately start talking. I hear them talking. I really do. But I'm so focused on what I'm doing that I'll say, hold on, wait a second. First off, you're talking way too fast for my old ears. So, enunciate a little more. But I heard you, but I wasn't listening. Would you say it again? I wonder if sometimes we don't treat God like that. Here we are, we're at church, the word of God is being preached, right? It's being preached, you hear it, right? You hear it? But are we listening? Am I listening? Judah was like that useless, rotten belt because they chose not to listen. Church, learn from their mistake. Be a useful belt. Listen, you could be a well-worn belt for all I care. Just be useful. Judah would eventually ignore God and his prophet for so long that God saw them as useless. May that never be said of us. But I'll tell you what happens if we leave our spiritual life unattended. It begins to rot away. Just like the belt in our story. If we water down the gospel, and we try to fit it to some narrative to try and make the truth a little bit more palatable, we're going to become as useless as this belt. Being a useful belt, hear me, this is important. Being a useful belt is not about being perfect. You can't be perfect. take it from a recovering perfectionist. Okay, you can't. And here's the thing. God doesn't expect you to be perfect because he knows you can't be. He wants you to be attentive and listening. In the end, what he wants is your heart. It is about the heart. You're not going to be perfect, but he wants to know that he has your heart, that your heart is in the right place. He knows you're going to stumble from time to time, but he wants to know, are you going to cling to him like a belt? And that from the depths of your heart, you're going to strive to follow him. Even when you fall down, you get back up and you keep following him and his word. Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 2, it talks about this whole issue of the heart. When it's speaking about the Israelites as they traveled for 40 years in the wilderness, here's what it says. Remember how the Lord your God led you all the way in the desert these 40 years to humble you and to test you in order to know what was in your heart, whether or not you would keep his commands. He wants to know what's in your heart. Not can you be perfect, but what's in your heart? And that will determine how useful you can be in his kingdom. I feel like too many people want to know what's the minimum requirement. Right? I mean, we see this. I know that those of you who teach, you know this with your students. What's the minimum I have to do to pass? What's the minimum I have to do to get a decent grade? They just want to know, well, what's the minimum requirement? Guys, that doesn't work in the kingdom. That's not a heart that God can use. I mean, it's just not. That's a belt that's barely hanging on. To be a useful belt, we need to be all in. Cling to the Lord, church. Be that useful belt. Paul used a similar image when he was talking to Timothy. Instead of a belt, he uses this image of a utensil. Here's what he says to him in 2 Timothy chapter 2, starting in verse 20. He says, in a wealthy home, some utensils are made of gold and silver. Some are made of wood and clay. The expensive utensils are used for special occasions. The cheap ones are for everyday use. If you keep yourself pure, you'll be a special utensil for honorable use. Your life will be clean and you'll be ready for the master to use you for every good work. We understand this, right? I know you do. Because when you have company over, most likely, depending on, I mean, if you're having a cookout, you might get out the paper plates, but you get out like the Chinette paper plates, right? Not the cheap flimsy ones that you used to warm up your pizza from the day before. We're, you know, a little bit nicer paper plates. But if you're having a nice sit-down meal, you have your good china, your good plates. I know that my mom, every Christmas, every Thanksgiving, she gets out the good china, these things that we never see that go back in the cabinet for months and months. She has to clean them before she uses them and cleans them afterward. Why? Because it's a special thing. And here, Paul, same image. It's the same image that Jeremiah is using. He says, listen, you can be a useful utensil. You can be a useful belt. You just need to cling to the Lord and listen to him. The next time that you feel like God can't use you, that you feel like, you know, I don't measure up, I want you to remember some things. I want you to remember that Noah was a drunk. Abraham was too old. Jacob was a liar. Leah was ugly. Joseph was abused. Moses had a stuttering problem. Gideon was afraid. Samson had long hair. That wasn't really his problem. He was a womanizer. That was Samson's problem. Rahab was a prostitute. God still used her. Jeremiah, too young. David has an affair and is a murderer. Elijah was suicidal. Jonah ran from God. Naomi was a widow. John the Baptist ate bugs. Peter, he denied Christ. The disciples fell asleep while they were praying. Martha worried about everything. Mary Magdalene was demon-possessed. Zacchaeus was too small. Paul was too religious. Timothy had too many ulcers. And Zacchaeus was a wee little man. And Lazarus was dead. Guys, there's no excuses. He can use any of us, any one of us. Trust me, he's using me, and I can't figure that out sometimes. He can use any of you. Be that useful belt. Learn from the mistakes of the past. Cling to the Lord and listen to his voice. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much. These images, these symbols are such a great reminder. They make the text come alive. I know it definitely did for Judah. I would hope. I guess they just didn't listen, but I suppose we're not that much better sometimes. But we thank you for the image that just reminds us we are that belt, that we're supposed to cling to you, to hold tight to you, even when things get rocky and when things are great. It doesn't matter. Just hold tight to you. And so, Lord, I pray you will help each of us to do that. We'll cling to you in the good and bad times and listen. That we'll listen to what you have to say through your word, through those that teach and that preach, so that we might be as useful as we can. We know you can use anybody, and we see you using all sorts of people. And so we ask, Lord, that you would move in our hearts, that we might allow ourselves to be that useful vessel, whatever we would call it, a belt, a utensil, just useful in your kingdom. And we pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to have now, as we normally do, our time of prayer and praise and a time of decision as well, if anybody needed to make a decision this morning. Do we have live stream going? So they're there. So if you guys are watching live stream, we got you finally. But if you have a prayer request or praise, be sure and let us know so that we can be praying for you guys. But if you are here in the building and you have a prayer request or praise, then we'd love for you to come forward now as we stand and sing.
With thy love and power, let thy blessing.
worshiping with us today. Have a few prayer requests that came in, either folks calling me or just folks have mentioned things this morning. Dan and Sandra Redding, Dan called me yesterday. He and Sandra have COVID. They're doing okay, but he just wanted prayers that they can get past that quickly. So we can certainly be praying for them. Jordan Hughes, her grandmother fell and got cut pretty bad on her hand and on her arm. And she's got, her skin is so thin, they weren't able to stitch it up. So they're doing what they can for her. But we can be praying certainly for her. Linda Kendrick found out, went in and had some an ultrasound done. And she has some nodules on the lymph nodes in her neck. They don't know that it's cancerous or anything like that yet, but they're hopefully next week they'll get some more answers. So we're just going to pray that that it's not, and so that will be our prayer certainly this morning and has been since you mentioned it. Yes. Absolutely. And then Wayne Jones, he asked prayer for Granville Chisholm. That's Pauline's brother, so it will be his brother-in-law. He has cancer. At this point, there's nothing they can do, anything, and so they've been calling the family in, the kids in. And so if you guys would just be praying for the Chisholm family, I know that Wayne and his family would appreciate that. And then a praise that I want to mention, and I should have mentioned this a few weeks ago, but Vinny did a couple of baptisms in his pool here probably 2 or 3 weeks ago, and at one point called me just to double check, got the wording right and everything for it, but proud of you for doing that, and that's awesome. So we had a couple of pool baptisms, and may have a few more here on the horizon here at the church as well. And so also, don't forget to be praying for our students at CIY as well. That's an emotional week for them. And so just be sure and be praying for them. Yes.
I would just like to mention
the family visits. Yes, absolutely. Had the wedding on Friday, and everything went well. And still got a few stragglers here. But glad that you guys were able to do that here and everything went well. So I'm glad to have you this morning. Don't forget that if you've got a physical offering to give, to drop that off at the plates at either side of the worship center. If you're giving online, then certainly that works. If you want to give through the app, you can do that as well. Download that app and you can give straight through there. Let me pray for us and I'll let you guys go. Father, we come before you this morning and have some folks we want to lay at your feet that are dealing with some different physical ailments. For Dan and Sandra, I know they're doing okay, but just ask that you would allow them to get over their sickness here very quickly and back on their feet, back to normal life for them. We want to lift up Jordan's grandmother who fell, and I'm not saw the pictures, not exactly sure what they will do to address that other than just some bandages and checking on it to make sure it doesn't get infected, but whatever they need to do to get her healed up, allow them to just make those correct decisions, and we do pray that there wouldn't be any major infection. Lord, for Linda, we just pray that the nodules that they found would not be anything that is cancerous, and so that's our prayer right now, and if that changes, Lord, then we'll certainly change what we're asking, but right now we believe that can be the case. She has come through this incredibly well, but we ask that you would just help her as she finishes this out, so to speak. We also want to lift up the Chisholm family, and we just pray that you allow all the children and whoever needs to get there has an opportunity to get to Pauline's brother, Wayne's brother-in-law, to see him, to spend a little bit of time with him, to say their goodbyes. And it's thank you, Lord, for giving him a fairly long life here, but allow these last few days to be something that the family can love on one another as they go through this. And then we just praise you for Vinny's heart, for these folks that he has been talking to and witnessing to and bringing them to Christ and even performing those baptisms in the pool here just a few weeks ago. And so just proud of him for that and ask you continue to use him in a mighty way and the opportunities that he has and in the different places that he works. And so, Lord, we just ask you to watch over him, his family. For us, as we leave here, just remind us that we are that belt, that we are that utensil, that we have to be useful. We need to be useful in the kingdom, and we can be. No matter what we may think of ourselves or where we've come from or what we're going through, we can be used by you. We know that. And I think sometimes we just need a reminder like this. And so use us, Lord. Use us however you want to. And we pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Love you guys. Have a great week.